Good morning. I am Phyllis Silver, Executive Director of the Partnership for Quality Care, and it's my privilege to welcome you to this first webinar in our series as we address the growing threat of superbugs that are difficult and sometimes impossible to treat. This is, as you all are aware, an emerging situation that we as healthcare workers and healthcare providers find ourselves facing with bacteria that are increasingly resistant to antibiotics. PQC is a national labor management coalition, fortunate to claim as members some of the nation's leading health systems and more than a million SEIU healthcare workers. Together, our members care for more than 50 million patients each year. Our unprecedented labor management partnership is especially appreciative to once again be able to collaborate with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention on an issue of such importance. Many of you will recall that in the fall of 2014, PQC sponsored educational sessions that were led by CDC, in fact, led by Arjun Srinivasan, to prepare and educate our frontline healthcare workforce about Ebola. Fortunately, although prepared, Ebola did not really reach our shores in a significant way. The size of today's audience on this webinar, which is approaching 1,400 individuals at launch time, is a reflection of the national concern about this issue of antimicrobial resistance. So thank you for joining our webinar series today. We will keep you on our mailing list as we collaborate with CDC over the next 6 months. Today's conversation will be a high-level overview, and in the next 6 months, the series will be addressing three specific areas in much more detail: antibiotic stewardship, appropriate prescribing of antibiotics in the community, and the role of the environment and environmental workers sharing practical strategies to stay ahead of the situation. If you have ideas for future webinars, when you go to the PQC website, after this, we'll give you that information at the end after the Q&A session, you will find an address where we would encourage you to provide us with some ideas for future webinars. Let us know what you're interested in hearing about. A few words of housekeeping before we begin. You will note that only speakers have mics. Everyone else is muted. You are invited to write questions in the chat room on the lower left of your screen, and I see people have already figured that out. After Drs. Callan and Srinivasan have completed their presentations, Dr. Steve Perotti of Kaiser Permanente, who is actually leading the PQC-CDC effort about antibiotic use in the community, is serving today to pull questions as he has offered to moderate the Q&A session for us that will follow the presentations. You will be sent the slide deck shortly after today's session. And in addition, you will be able to find a recording of the webinar on the PQC website later today. That's our goal. That would be pqc-usa.org, and we will post that link during the Q&A session. So at this time, it's my honor to turn the microphone over to our first faculty member, Dr. Alex Callan, a physician board certified infectious disease and internal medicine physician who serves as the lead of the antimicrobial resistance and emerging pathogens team in the Division of Healthcare Quality Promotion at CDC. Dr. Callan practices clinically as a volunteer attending physician at the Atlanta Veterans Affairs Medical Center. I thank you, Dr. Callan, for all that you do and for joining us today. Turning it over to you, Dr. Callan.
Great. Thanks very much. I am going to talk in the first part here to provide an update on emerging resistance that CDC is paying close attention to. Primarily, that will be about Clostridium resistance mediated by MCR1, but I'm going to mention a couple other pathogens at the end and then finish up with just some high-level thoughts about this new approach to aggressively target emerging resistance here in the U.S. So let me switch the slides. Okay, great. So let's start at kind of the beginning, because I know we probably have a relatively broad audience here. When talking about the resistance inferred by the MCR1 gene, we're really talking about a class of antibiotics called the polymyxins, which in the U.S. primarily are two drugs, polymyxin B and colistin, which is polymyxin E. These drugs have really pretty broad activity against gram-negative bacteria, and in the U.S. are primarily used topically or IV for highly resistant organisms. These drugs have been out around a long time, but are associated with a number of toxicities when they came out, mostly for the kidneys and for the neurologic toxicities. And so they weren't used a lot. After they were released, there were other options, so they kind of fell to the side. This maybe was a little bit of a good thing because with the emergence of highly resistant gram negatives, especially carbapenem resistant and Enterobacteriaceae, they have found a new role in being used IV to treat some really resistant organisms, especially in places that are seeing a lot of CRE. It's also used in animals, primarily to treat disease. There is resistance to colistin and the polymyxins that is not related to MCR1, and this has been around for a long time. It's primarily related to some modifications of the binding site for polymyxin, but this resistance is chromosomal. For those of you that follow this, chromosomal resistance tends to be a little bit more difficult to spread, while plasmid-mediated resistance, because it's on a highly mobile genetic element, like the MCR1 gene is on a plasmid, tends to be spread more easily between bacteria and then potentially to other patients. If you look in our collection, which admittedly is not a huge representative sample, at least of the CRE, about somewhere between 7% and 10% of CRE have MICs to colistin greater than 4 micrograms per milliliter. So just one other word to be precise, there are no CLSI breakpoints for Enterobacteriaceae for colistin non-susceptibility. So when I say colistin resistance, I am taking a little bit of a liberty and referring to Enterobacteriaceae isolates with MIC greater than or equal to 4 micrograms per milliliter. It's also important to recognize that some Enterobacteriaceae have baseline elevated MICs to colistin, things like Morganella, et cetera. And then the very common Enterobacteriaceae, Enterobacter, that genus, does kind of, if you look at the natural distribution of the MICs to Enterobacter, they do kind of overlap a little bit, these higher MICs. So there certainly are ones in the normal distribution that have MICs that are a little bit higher. So what about MCR1 gene? So this, as many of you know, was first reported in November of 2015 from a report from China. At the time of the report, it was pretty clear that this probably had been going on for a while, as you know, somewhere between 15% of the raw meat samples that they tested, 21% of animal samples they tested were positive. Only about 1% of human healthcare samples, and they tested about 1,300 of those, were the isolates from those samples were positive for Enterobacteriaceae isolates, E. coli in this case, with MCR1 gene. This distribution, with it primarily found in animals and meat, has suggested to some that this is a resistance mechanism that has emerged in animals, including food animals, and has spread to humans. So since that report, obviously lots of people have been looking for this resistance mutations, and so a number of retrospective reviews of collected collections has gone on, as well as prospective surveillance. And from that, we know a couple of things. First is that this this resistance mutation or gene can be found as far back as the 1980s. I think the earliest that I'm aware of so far has been from chickens in China in the 1980s, and the first human isolate that we're aware of was from 2008. Interestingly, this has primarily, to date, been reported from E. coli, but we have seen it in a couple of other Enterobacteriaceae species, including Klebsiella pneumoniae, Salmonella, Shigella, et cetera. And the plasmids that this tends to be on do seem to have a relatively high transmission rate. So in other words, it tends to spread relatively easily between bacteria. The MCR1 gene has now been found pretty much globally from more than 20 countries and isolated from a number of sources, again, primarily from food animals and meat, but also from the environment. There's a report of river water, vegetables. There's actually a report of it from seagulls. As far as patients are concerned, it has been identified in both ill patients, so patients with clinical cultures, usually collected for some illness, and also from asymptomatically colonized people. And frequently this is when patients return from travel overseas or outside their home country. There are a bunch of folks who screen these people and have identified this amongst those people. Interestingly, among that group of people, it does seem, as we have seen with other resistant Enterobacteria ACA like CRE, NDM producing CRE, et cetera, that these folks who presumably have relatively healthy microbiomes in their GI tract do tend to stay colonized for relatively short periods of time, like less than a month. So why do we think that MCR1 is potentially important? And I think it's important to recognize that this is, at least in the isolates that we've identified in the United States, not associated with these bacteria that are completely pan-resistant to everything. In fact, the isolates that we've seen to date in the U.S. Have had lots of other things that they remain susceptible to, including the aminoglycosides and carbapenems, et cetera. However, this is a plasmid-mediated resistance mechanism that has a high probability of spread between bacteria. And the concern is that this resistance mutation can move from these isolates that have MCR1 to isolates that are more highly resistant, CRE, et cetera, for which colistin or which the polymyxins may be one of the only alternatives for treatment, further reducing or potentially eliminating other treatment options. So really the goal here is to intervene early to prevent the movement of this isolate into these very highly resistant, or this plasmid into these very highly resistant strains. So just a few details about the MCR1 gene in the United States. So as I'm sure many of you know, the first report was from May of 2016 when investigators from the Department of Defense reported an E. coli in a patient from Pennsylvania that contained the MCR1 gene. Since that time, and including that isolate, there are now four known or suspected human MCR1 isolates in the United States under investigation among humans again. All these so far have been in the northeastern United States. Only one has any potential travel associated with the infection. The others did not. All these isolates, as I mentioned before, seem to be susceptible to other things like carbapenems and things like that, and we have seen but have been resistant to other third-generation cephalosporins, et cetera, and have either contained an extended-spectrum beta-lactamase or an AMPSI. So these aren't entirely pan-susceptible isolates, but they're also not pan-resistant as well. In the cases that have been fully investigated, again, some of these are still ongoing, no transmission has been identified, and we, similar to what I described before, have primarily seen this in E. coli. In addition to the human isolates, there are two reports of porcine E. coli carrying the MCR1 gene as well. As we often see with this emerging resistance, we start to see new alleles, and that is true of this as well. There is now a report of MCR2 from Belgium, which this particular gene had about 77% homology with the MCR1 gene. And actually, it was interesting if you review that report that actually MCR2 was just a little bit more common than the MCR1 gene among these porcine and bovine E. coli. I will also say, I forgot to mention on the last slide, the MICs that we have seen to colistin here so far have ranged between 2 and 8, most of them between 4 and 8 micrograms per milliliter. So just summarized here are the recommendations that came out in the health alert notice from June 13, 2016 from CDC. I'll just quickly go through them, but basically for infection prevention, we are currently recommending standards for patients colonized or infected with these organisms that the standard and contact precautions be used when they're in inpatient healthcare settings. The second thing about laboratory testing I think is important. Currently, we are not recommending that folks screen Enterobacteria ACA for colistin resistance except if it's being used for clinical care. So if you're have an isolate for which you're doing testing or potentially need to use a polymyxin for clinical care, you should, that would be the situation where you would screen these isolates for this resistance. And if you have isolates with a clistinomyc of 4 micrograms per milliliter higher, it should be tested for confirmation both to the MIC and for the presence of MCR1. And of course, this can be done via your state health department, and then if they forward it on to CDC. There are a couple exceptions to that. As I said, there are a number of strains that have kind of intrinsic higher levels, MICs to clistin. That includes things like Morganella, et cetera. And then for Enterobacter species, as I said, this kind of overlaps a little bit with the distribution of these strains. The wild-type distribution does overlap a little bit with these higher MICs. So if you have an Enterobacter species, we would only recommend that be sent if there are other risk factors, which primarily at this point is travel outside the United States to a place that has described MCR1. Just as an aside, CDC is making test bacteria with elevated clistinomyces available for validation of laboratory testing through the FDA CDC-AR bacteria isolate bank. So if you're interested in that, keep your eye out for that. And then I think, you know, we're also concerned about environmental cleaning, and if you have an inpatient with the MCR1 gene, you should really pay close attention to both the daily and terminal cleaning of these rooms to prevent transmission. And I would also add to that, since we've seen more and more reports of persistent colonization or contamination of sinks from highly resistant gram negatives, that to avoid spending patient samples down sink drains. And then perhaps most important, probably should have been first, not last, but MCR1 isolate should be reported to public health. I also wanted to say a few words about a couple other emerging pathogens, resistant pathogens that we're paying close attention to it here at CDC. Just a few words about Candida auris. This is a yeast that was first described in 2009 from Japan from an ear infection, hence the auris. It can be highly resistant to all three main classes of antifungals. It's almost always resistant to the azoles, and then can also have resistance to amphotericin and echinocandins. And we have become aware that since 2009, this strain seems to have emerged as a cause of clusters of healthcare-associated infections in several countries and has displayed some of the characteristics that we haven't typically seen with Candida auris that may set it up for outbreaks in healthcare settings. That includes relatively high and persistent contamination of the skin of patients, which obviously is a problem with patient-to-patient transmission, usually via the hands of healthcare workers or devices, and then, of course, persistent environmental contamination that can also lead to transmission from patient to patient. So again, these characteristics, not really typically seen with Candida, have led to a number of outbreaks in countries around the world, not here in the United States yet, but in other places around the world. So for those of you that didn't see it, there was a health alert about Candida auris that came out from CDC in June 24, 2016. Facilities with known or suspected C. auris should notify public health, and I really apologize for that horrible typo there. That should be candidaauris@cdc.gov, so they should be reported to your state local health department, and they could also be reported to CDC via that email address. One of the problems with C. auris, it is difficult to differentiate except by MALDI-TOF, and can be confused with other candida, including Candida hemolonium, alonii. So the isolates that are identified as hemolonii or other candida that are not further speciated can be sent to CDC, at least for now, for further identification. We are also recommending standard and contact precautions and single rooms for patients known to be colonized or infected with Candida auris. And again, highlight the importance of aggressive daily and terminal cleans using a hospital-grade disinfectant with a fungal clean when these patients are identified. Just a quick word about ceftazidime avibactam. This is an antibiotic that was approved in 2015 with broad activity against resistant gram-negatives, and particularly important, has great activity against class A carbapenemases, including KPC, and so this is an important niche for this drug. Resistance to this seems to be relatively uncommon. Only 11 of more than 20,000 strains from one large study were non-susceptible, and some of these were metallo-beta-lactamases like NDM, which would be resistant to these anyway. We now know of our second non-susceptible isolate from a KPC-producing CRE. The first one was reported in the literature from UCLA, and now we have a second one. So again, this is something we're paying close attention to, and obviously we don't want to lose this drug for people with class A carbapenemases. Of note, for those of you that follow this, I guess there are issues with producing the AV backdam portion of this, so this drug has really become not available and will be available again in about 2017. Certainly, if you see isolates with resistance to this antibiotic as well, public health should be alerted. And just lastly, a couple words about this kind of new and more aggressive response to emerging resistance. As of this year, all state and some local health departments will be funded to respond to AR threats, including emerging threats like this in their jurisdictions, including the provision of technical assistance, the ability to help with contact investigations and laboratory support. And I think this is part of a new approach with public health taking the lead on an aggressive evaluation when these cases are identified to ensure that there's that transmission is limited and to prevent outbreaks and the emergence and subsequently the emergence of this resistance in jurisdictions. Of course, what constitutes novel resistance might vary from region to region. Certainly, all the things I mentioned would probably constitute novel resistance in any region, but certainly places that aren't seeing a lot of non-KPC carbapenemases like NDMs, that might be a problem. In some places that aren't seeing a lot of CRE, this might constitute novel resistance. So I think this is something providers and facilities should be aware of, this kind of emerging role for public health. And lastly, I wanted to provide you some suggestions about what facilities and healthcare providers can do to help prevent the spread of novel resistance. And this is from a document that's highlighted, that's on the web there, highlighted below if you'd like more details. But I think the important things to recall when these pathogens are identified that a facility should recommend or institute recommended infection control precautions, which may vary from pathogen to pathogen. They should notify public health and work with public health to implement the recommended interventions. It's always important to remember to save the isolates. When these isolates are identified, one of the first steps is to implement prospective and retrospective surveillance to identify isolates with similar phenotypes. So that might be a lab look back to look for isolates with similar resistance patterns, and then devising a scheme to look for these moving forward from your clinical cultures in your laboratory. If the patient is transferred from a facility, then it's important, and you identify a novel resistance, that you go back and notify the transferring facility. And if the patient is being transferred, it's important to notify the accepting facility as well. And last but not least, it's important to implement a method to identify known or colonized infected patients at readmission. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Arjun Srinivasan. Arjun is an infectious disease physician and a captain in the U.S. Public Health Service. He is serves as the Associate Director for Healthcare-Associated Infection Prevention Programs in the Division of Healthcare Quality Promotion at CDC. Arjun?
Thanks so much, Alex. So what I'd like to do is take a little bit of a broad overview of some of the things that we can do to try and address some of the problems that Alex just described for us so well. And I really wanted to begin with discussing what this means to us as frontline healthcare providers, whatever our role may be, whether you are working in the microbiology lab, environmental services, nutrition services, or if you are a clinician, we are all part of a healthcare workforce. And as we learned, very vividly during Ebola, these types of new pathogens often have implications for us. And so what are those implications? The good news is with these drug-resistant organisms is that the threat to us as healthcare workers is very, very different than what we experienced with Ebola. With Ebola, very, very highly transmissible pathogen, and a pathogen very capable of infecting healthy individuals. So a significant threat to us as healthcare workers that we needed to protect very, very carefully against. For antibiotic-resistant organisms, the threats are somewhat different. They don't spread through the air like flu or measles, so these aren't things that you can that can transmit over a long distance. And they don't spread as easily on surfaces as something like Ebola. So they're not as highly transmissible as some of these other pathogens that we encounter in healthcare. The other thing that we've noticed, and Alex pointed out, is that oftentimes our own healthy bacteria serve as a bit of a barrier, a protection against some of these drug-resistant organisms. So when we are healthcare workers with healthy, normal microbes and bacteria living in our guts, we do have some protection against some of these organisms. And so the infections that we tend to see are in our patients and really in our most vulnerable patients. So I think there are some very important differences between things like the MCR1-containing bacteria, the carbapenem-resistant Enterobacteriaceae. Those are very different from organisms like Ebola, and I think that's an important thing for us to know and for us to help other people understand. We know that if we follow recommended precautions, like Alex just mentioned, standard precautions, cleaning our hands like we're supposed to, wearing the contact precautions, the gowns and gloves like we're supposed to, we're very, very well protected from contracting these bacteria. So these bacteria don't really pose a major risk to us as a healthcare workforce, and we're certainly able to mitigate the risks to ourselves from these bacteria. But we as the healthcare workforce do play a really important role here in addressing, combating these resistant organisms. And the transmission of these pathogens, as Alex, I think, alluded to, is very complex, and that means we really have to have a truly multifaceted effort to address this problem. You know, the big areas that we are going to talk about today in this initiative with PQC is really focused are on two areas, environmental cleaning and improving antibiotic use. And sometimes people say, well, you know, that's a lot to do. Why don't we pick one or the other and try to focus on that? And the challenge, of course, is that environmental cleaning is going to be less effective if your antibiotic use is out of control and you're breeding all of these resistant organisms. And on the flip side, even if you're doing a great job trying to improve antibiotics, if the environment is covered in these resistant organisms, there is still the potential that they will spread. So it really is has to be a multi-pronged approach. And it also has to be a team effort. None of these are things that an individual provider can address on their own. This is truly one of those circumstances where the chain is only as strong as its weakest link. We are all really in this together. So let me talk a little bit about the various things that we can do to address this problem of resistance, and we're going to focus on a couple today. The first, of course, is the environment of care. And we know that bacteria, including resistant bacteria, can be spread through the environment. And in the past, the most important way we knew these bacteria were spread were on our hands of healthcare workers, failure to clean our hands properly. We certainly are doing a lot better with that. I would never say that there's not some room for improvement with hand hygiene, but I think many of you are probably aware that we're really getting quite good at that in our healthcare facilities with alcohol-based hand rubs and reminders and team efforts, and we are seeing very good compliance with hand hygiene. However, we are now beginning to recognize that the contamination of surfaces and items in our healthcare environment is increasingly a problem in the transmission of these drug-resistant organisms. And that's not terribly surprising when we think about the complexity of the healthcare environment. This is a very nice picture from a group in Chicago of a typical patient care room. This is an ICU room, and you can see there are a lot of different things that are in that room, and each one of these has to be cleaned. Someone has to clean all these things every time the patient leaves the room. What those green X's represent are the different places where this team was able to find drug-resistant bacteria when they went through and cultured all the different surfaces in the room. So you can see pretty much everything in the patient care environment gets contaminated while we have a patient in the room. And this is a complex situation. And you look there, you can see there's a ventilator. And that question then arises, well, who is going to clean that ventilator? Is that the job of the environmental services staff? Is that a nursing duty? Is that a respiratory therapy duty? So it's not just that there's a lot of stuff in this room. There are some complexities with respect to who is supposed to clean all of it. And it creates a very complex and dynamic environment in the healthcare setting, which, of course, then favors contamination. The other thing that can lead to this type of environmental contamination is the fact that some of these bacteria, some of these resistant ones that we're dealing with, can live for very long periods of time on surfaces. So once they get put there, they can stay there for a while, which means that if they're not removed by cleaning, they could be there waiting to infect the next person who comes into the room. The good news is that we can improve environmental cleaning with some fairly straightforward educational interventions. And this is just one example that I'll show you. The bars on the top show the percent of these surfaces that were cleaned before there was a good training of the environmental staff, and the bars at the bottom show how much better the environmental cleaning got after they engaged in a collaborative program of working with environmental services staff to provide them with the education that they needed. And as part of this and other studies, there have been a lot of discussions with folks in environmental services to really try and figure out what are the factors that lead to and create challenges with a proper cleaning of the environment. And I think there are two that are really identified over and over again. And I'd be willing to bet that those of you who either work in environmental services or are familiar with it would agree that these are probably challenges that you have faced as well. The first is insufficient training. And people have said that deals both with the supplies that we're dealing with. There are different cleaners that hospitals use. They have to be mixed up, diluted in different ways, and so people need to know how exactly to use all of the cleaners that they are being asked to use, and that's especially true if you change the products that you're using. And also the cleaning procedures. As I mentioned earlier, who cleans each piece of equipment in that room? There has to be accountability for every surface in that room so that you know exactly who is responsible for cleaning it. The second big issue that we face, of course, is the fact that there's just not enough time allocated to properly clean the room. We've talked with environmental services folks who will say, look, we really need 45 minutes to clean that room. You know, we have done this over and over again, and that's really how much time that we need, but we're being asked to do it in 30 because we're always in a bed crunch situation, and that's obviously going to lead to problems. And I think both of these boil down to the need that we have to really support our environmental services staff to ensure that they have not only the training that they need and the resources, but also the time they need to do a proper job in cleaning the rooms. That's the environmental piece. Let me turn and talk about the other driving factor of antibiotic resistance that's very much under our power to control, and that's with antibiotic stewardship. We've talked a little bit already about antibiotic resistance. I will mention that we do believe that this is one of the most important threats that our patients face these days. And what it means is that the bacteria that we're trying to treat can no longer be treated by the antibiotics that we'd like to use. And so as the example Alex gave, we are oftentimes forced to use these older antibiotics, things like colistin, that are much more toxic than the antibiotics that we would like to use. Antibiotic resistance fundamentally threatens our ability to deliver the type of advanced medical care that we've really become accustomed to delivering. So when you think about the patients who are at the highest risk for these types of infections, these drug-resistant organisms, they're some of our most vulnerable patients. They're our cancer patients, our patients who are undergoing complex surgery, joint replacements, who are getting immune suppressive therapies. These are the patients who are at highest risk of these drug-resistant organisms and who can least afford to get these types of infections. The other thing to keep in mind is that if we lose effective therapy, if we lose antibiotic therapy, infections that currently are very treatable and are seldom deadly could again become very, very serious threats to life. Think about the Enterobacteriaceae, E. coli being the most common there. Well, that's the most common cause of outpatient urinary tract infections. If we see increased resistance, if these plasmids with things like carbapenem resistance and colistin resistance get into community strains of E. coli, we could be facing a situation where you have outpatient urinary tract infections being caused by these organisms that are difficult, if not impossible, to treat. So this is a very serious challenge that we face for the way that we deliver medicine. We at the CDC tried a few years ago to convey the human toll of antibiotic resistance writ large on the United States. We took data from the surveillance systems that we use in CDC to produce some estimates of how many of these resistant organisms that we see, and we did this in 2013. And the bottom line is that there are a large number already of these resistant organisms in the United States every year. We estimate that about 2 million people every year get an infection with an organism that's resistant to the antibiotic that their provider would like to use to treat them. And about 23,000 of those patients die. And it's not just the problem of antibiotic-resistant organisms. There's also the issue of Clostridium difficile. Clostridium difficile, many of you are very familiar with it. It's a bacteria that causes severe diarrhea. And we group Clostridium difficile with these antibiotic-resistant pathogens, not because the Clostridium difficile itself is resistant, but because the factors that are driving the current epidemic of Clostridium difficile in the United States are exactly the same factors that we just talked about that lead to antibiotic resistance. It's overuse of antibiotics, exposure to antibiotics, and then environmental contamination. We estimate that every year in the United States there are about 450,000 cases of Clostridium difficile. Most of these are related to healthcare. Almost all of them are in patients who have some exposure to antibiotics. About 15,000 of these patients die. And the majority of those deaths, 80% of those deaths, are in older patients. And one thing I always like to show this slide as a reminder that it's easy to talk about statistics and these big numbers. But it's important to remember the human toll of these infections. This is a picture of Peggy Lillis. Peggy was a kindergarten teacher who developed a Clostridium difficile infection after getting a course of antibiotics for a dental procedure, and she subsequently died from that infection, leaving behind two sons. And so it's always important to remember that though we are talking about big numbers, 2,400,000, behind every one of those numbers is a story like this one. And that is why we are so focused on trying to address this problem. Combating antibiotic resistance in the United States has now become a top priority for the entire government. The White House has really taken a leadership role in trying to bring not just the government, but all of the relevant groups together to try and address the problem of antibiotic resistance, to try and solve it before it gets even more of a problem. In looking at the ways that we can address that, we know that some of them are out of our control. We cannot right now change the way that bacteria mutate and develop resistance. But some of the most important factors that are driving antibiotic resistance are very much within our control, and they're really the two that we've been talking about today: the spread of these organisms in the environment, which we can deal with environmental cleaning, and the overuse of antibiotics that we can address through antibiotic stewardship. And I really do believe that the Partnership for Quality Care, with the very diverse membership that it has, is uniquely positioned to try and address both of these and a number of very important health systems throughout the United States. I'll say a few words about antibiotic use and antibiotic stewardship. We know that antibiotics are overused throughout our healthcare systems. If you look at reports about how much antibiotic use is unnecessary, that number is somewhere between 30 and up to 70% in some studies in nursing homes. And of course, we know that happens in agriculture as well. Antibiotic overuse has a number of important adverse consequences. And I think that those occur both at an individual patient level and also a societal level. From the patient's perspective, if you get an antibiotic, there are a number of important side effects that are caused by antibiotics. And we know that. Antibiotics are no different than any other medication. All medications have side effects. The issue here arises that if I get an antibiotic that I don't need, I am being exposed to side effects with no potential benefit. And so we know that every year, about 140,000 people end up in an emergency room because they got a side effect from an antibiotic. Well, if a third of those people didn't need the antibiotic in the first place, that's tens of thousands of people who end up in an emergency room unnecessarily. Antibiotics can cause rashes. They can damage kidneys. They, as we've been talking about, select for these more resistant bacteria, and they lead to Clostridium difficile infections. Now, when we need an antibiotic, of course, those are all risks that we are ready to accept. The issue becomes is we don't want to expose our patients to these risks unnecessarily. From a societal perspective, the issue of antibiotic overuse, it's really this issue that antibiotics are unique among all classes of drugs. Because when we, if we overuse an antibiotic, there's the potential that we can breed a resistant organism in a patient or select for Clostridium difficile in a patient. And then that bacteria can spread from that patient to other patients who never even got the antibiotic. They could be spread within your hospital, or your patient might be transferred and may spread that organism in a facility that's down the road from you or even in another city or another state. And I think this makes antibiotics different from every other drug that we use, because the way that I use antibiotics sitting here in Atlanta, Georgia, can potentially impact the effectiveness of antibiotics in any healthcare facility wherever you are if you end up seeing my patients or if those organisms get spread to your patients. The good news is that we do have a lot of data that shows us that if we improve antibiotic use, we can achieve some very measurable direct benefits. We can reduce antibiotic resistance, we can reduce Clostridium difficile, and we can improve patient outcomes. And let me show you just a little bit of that data. This is a study where they looked at rates of antibiotic resistance before and after they started an antibiotic stewardship program. And as you can see, that across the board, their bacteria actually got more susceptible to antibiotics after they started their antibiotic stewardship program. So there is the possibility that good antibiotic stewardship can not just slow the development of resistance, it may even be able to reverse some of that resistance to make bacteria more susceptible. And most importantly, what we've found is that if you have a good antibiotic stewardship program, you are actually more likely to have your patients successfully cure their infections. This is a study where patients were randomized to either get whatever antibiotics the prescriber would normally prescribe or to get antibiotics based on recommendations from an antibiotic stewardship program. And as you can see, the patients who had input from the stewardship program were nearly three times more likely to get the correct antibiotic. And what that meant in terms of the real outcome was that they were 1.7 times more likely to have their infection cured, and they were 80% less likely to experience a treatment failure for that infection. So antibiotic stewardship programs actually help us take better care of our patients, which, of course, makes sense in an era where the management of infectious diseases has become only more complicated with drug resistance and lots of drug interactions. How do we achieve this goal? Well, studies have consistently shown us that the best way to optimize outcomes related to antibiotic use in hospitals is through the activities of a dedicated program, an antibiotic stewardship program. But how do we do that? We know that hospitals don't all look the same, which means that stewardship programs shouldn't all look the same. There needs to be flexibility in how these are implemented at the local level. But what we found is that there are some key factors that are associated with successful antibiotic stewardship programs. And we have worked with experts in the field, reviewed the literature, and have tried to summarize these best practices in this document, the core elements for hospital antibiotic stewardship programs. We do have, I'll mention as a side note, companion document for this that discusses the core elements of stewardship programs in nursing homes, and we're working on one for outpatient settings. But in the hospital setting, we think there are 7 key factors that have been associated with successful antibiotic stewardship programs, and those are summarized here. And those are that the leadership of the facility, so the chief medical officer, chief executive officer, chief nursing officer, are supportive of the program. They're committed to it. There's someone who's in charge of the program, and there's also a pharmacy leader of the program, that they're tracking antibiotic use, finding opportunities for improvement, that they're reporting information on antibiotic use and resistance back to providers, they're educating providers on use and resistance, and then they're working with providers to implement specific interventions to improve antibiotic use. Interventions, of course, are critical. It's really the whole point of those other 6 core elements are to lay a foundation that will allow you to implement an intervention that would meaningfully improve antibiotic prescribing. The question that sometimes comes up is, well, which intervention is the right one for me? And the bottom line is that you need to focus on interventions that are most meaningful at your institution. And to your providers. So talk with your providers, review your antibiotic use, and find a condition or an antibiotic where you think there's room for improvement, and then focus on that. Well, what's it going to take moving forward? Obviously, leadership commitment to making this happen is essential. And I think here, some of that work has been done. PQC, through Phyllis's leadership, has worked very hard to engage the leaders of the health systems in this in the partnership to really get them on board with this issue. And I'll point out that the leaders of these health systems are the ones who chose this topic, antibiotic stewardship, antibiotic resistance, and environmental cleaning. This was their decision. They wanted to be active in that. We know that teamwork is essential, and as I mentioned earlier, I think PQC is uniquely positioned when it comes to developing and building this team to get this work done. And I also think you've got a fantastic group of people who are supporting this effort. And with that, I'm actually going to turn it over to one of the leaders who is working with us to support this effort within the Partnership for Quality Care, and that's Stephen Perotti. Stephen's the Associate Executive Director of Kaiser Permanente, and he's the co-chair of the antimicrobial stewardship team for this Partnership for Quality Care initiative. And so I'm going to turn it over to Steve to handle some of the questions and answers. Steve?
Hey, thank you. And Dr. Kellen and Dr. Srinivasan, thank you very much for some very engaging presentations and highlighting the importance of multiple ways of tackling the issue of these particular resistant organisms, and then really multi-drug resistant organisms in general when it comes to infection prevention, stewardship, environmental services, the microbiology lab, and most importantly, the partnership between healthcare workers within large healthcare systems and the public health system as well. So we have gotten a large number of questions. I want to thank the audience, and either before this, these presentations and during this talk. So I'm going to try to summarize a few of the questions and ask Drs. Kellen, Srinivasan to give us their insights. So the first question I wanted to sort of ask you is around the infection prevention approaches. And I understand that it sounds like transmission has largely been person to person, and that standard and contact precautions are recommended. And there was some reference to the Canada being in a single room. And I'd like to understand from the NCR1 organism standpoint whether single rooms are also recommended. And beyond that, are there recommendations beyond the hospital in terms of extended care, skilled nursing facilities, and home settings?
Hi, this is Alex Callan. So, I mean, in general, I think anytime you have these novel emerging resistant organisms like MCR1, Candida auris, et cetera, you would want to, if you have single rooms available, you'd want to obviously use them. So I think that would be, you know, a pretty standard across the board and for other things too, including CRE and other highly resistant organisms. As far as your question about
the use of these interventions outside of acute care? It's a hard question to answer because I think, you know, when we talk about short stay and long-term acute care, I don't think anyone has any problems with the use of contact precautions. You know, it's a very high-risk setting. These are hopefully places that people won't be forever. When you're talking about long-term care and outpatient settings like dialysis, et cetera, it gets a lot more complicated. I think, you know, for many resistant pathogens, the approach to the use of contact precautions in long-term care settings can be a little bit different. You know, I use the term enhanced standard precautions, which is my own. It's not a CDC term. But I think, you know, thinking of the use of contact precautions in these settings where you have residents instead of patients and you have people, this is their home, so it's not necessarily a healthcare environment to them. So, you know, using contact precautions or gowns and gloves when you are doing things that will put you at high risk for contaminating yourself or your hands, things like, you know, bathing the patients, helping the patient to toilet, things like that makes a lot of sense. And then taking a less aggressive approach when people are, you know, you're going in to remove a tray or something like that. So, in other words, it's kind of a aggressive approach with gowns and gloves when you're doing things that are likely to contaminate yourself and a less of aggressive approach when you're not. So I think, you know, there's that certainly makes a lot of sense. Certainly if people are very high risk, they're not containing, they have stool that's not contained or wound dressing that's difficult to contain, et cetera. I mean, you may kick up your contact precautions kind of to more resemble what you're seeing in acute care. But I think, you know, it is a challenging issue and one that we continue to struggle with. But I think, you know, that dichotomy you should keep in mind when using these kind of precautions in long-term care.
In the acute care setting, in terms of aggressiveness of enforcement, what has been the approach in the U.S.? Have we taken precautions such as have been taken with CRE, or is it something different?
You mean the types of infection control precautions?
Meaning, you know, strict monitoring of individuals going in and out of the rooms, and with respect to even isolating wards or that type of thing, has that level of aggressiveness been taken with these particular organisms?
So, I mean, for these things, obviously we haven't had clusters, et cetera, so generally no. I think what we generally recommend when people have one of these kind of pathogens among one of their inpatients is that they take the infection control folks take the time to review the use of contact precautions and, of course, hand hygiene, which is of critical importance in general on the ward with the patients, the people that may be taking care of them, not just the nurses, but all the people taking care of them. But we haven't gone to recommending, you know, having monitors at the door, et cetera, like they have done at some facilities. As far as cohorting, which I think, you know, that is that's basically taking all the patients with the same resistant organism and putting them in one place and using the same healthcare providers to care for them. You know, I think that is a precaution that does make sense when you have a number of these patients in your facility at one time, but doesn't make as much sense when you have just a single patient periodically, so we haven't used those. Certainly, if you had a cluster of these organisms, like an outbreak or something like that, then by all means we would recommend that. But I think for individual cases where you just have single cases at one time, the logistics and the benefit probably are less, and so we haven't recommended them.
Arjun, you had talked about environmental cleaning, so I wanted to follow up with you on what is effective for environmental cleaning for these particular organisms. Is there something different that we need to do with respect to either chemicals, or is there something more aggressive that we need to do either with terminal cleaning or with cleaning while the patient is in the room during their hospitalization?
Yeah, thanks, Steve. Appreciate that. That is a really good point to emphasize. What we know about these pathogens is that they're not resistant to the types of chemicals that we would use. So any standard hospital disinfectant should be effective against these organisms. So whatever you're using to clean your rooms would be effective against things like the MCR1 containing strains of E. coli against carbapenem-resistant Enterobacteriaceae. But I think the most important issue, though, is to that cleaning agent may be effective, but it's not effective if it doesn't get onto the surface and it doesn't sit on the surface for the amount of time that it's supposed to. And I think that is a really important issue. It's making sure that you've read the label, you understand, is this an agent that has to be wiped on and left wet for a period of time? Does it have to be left to dry, or can it be put on and then wiped off? You know, how exactly are you supposed to use that agent? So I think that is really key to understand. And then the other is the issue that I alluded to. It's making sure that every surface in that room, that there is accountability for cleaning all of those different surfaces within the room. And I think all of those things are really important. And one of the things that Alex also touched on and that you brought up is the importance of both the daily cleaning and the terminal cleaning. We know that daily cleaning is important to help keep the microbial load as low as possible while the patient's in the room. So that cannot be ignored. And then, of course, the terminal cleaning is the one that is the really thorough cleaning, and that needs to be detailed. There needs to be sufficient time and a really good procedure for doing that.
Thanks, Arjun. Alex, I had a question for you. There have been a number of questions regarding testing, and I appreciate your discussion around the importance of screening or not screening in this case. There's been some questions about is there anything we should be doing from a microbiology standpoint in terms of either being suspicious of an organism potentially harboring an MCR1? And it sounds like it may be difficult from a phenotypic standpoint, since organisms may be sensitive to other antimicrobials. So is there anything that either the laboratory or a clinician should be doing if they suspect that this might be present?
Again, our recommendation is that colistin susceptibility testing be done for clinical purposes and not for surveillance purposes. I mean, there's plenty of people doing surveillance studies now to try and better characterize the prevalence of this in different areas around the United States, including here at CDC and lots of other places. So, you know, and there's also, I don't want to touch on this too much, but there are lots of problems with how you actually do susceptibility testing, which is a whole complicated issue since, you know, most the cards that on the automated testing instruments that most people use do not have colistin, so you would have to use another methodology. However, I guess really the only risk factor that we're aware of, and again, it really hasn't panned out as much in the isolates that we've seen so far in the U.S., is, you know, travel to a healthcare, and especially healthcare exposure to places outside the United States where these have been described more frequently, you know, places in Asia, et cetera. So aside from that, it may be challenging to identify these at your individual facilities, and that, again, our recommendation would be that you worry about colistin testing when you're going to use this clinically and not for surveillance at this time.
Arjun, with respect to stewardship, I know we've sort of touched on today about the different approaches on the inpatient and a little bit on the outpatient side. With respect to MCR1, one of the questions that's come up that maybe you could speak to is that, you know, many places where we're using polymyxin are actually not in the hospital. Polymyxin's in over-the-counter products and is often used in a primary care setting. So I'm curious whether you have any thoughts about whether there are stewardship efforts that are untapped here with respect to the polymyxins.
Yeah, you know, Steve, that's a really good question. It's not something that I had really, really thought about. So I honestly don't know. I do know that one of the areas where, you know, of course, there is concern, and I'm not sure all the actions that are underway is, of course, the use of colistin in the animal sector. We know that colistin, you know, is used particularly in other countries. I don't think it's used in this country, but it is used in other countries. And so there have been issues with the use of colistin in agriculture, particularly in some of the porcine farming. And the question, of course, is, you know, the role that has played. And I think it emphasizes the need, and the polymyxin issue does as well, emphasize the fact that, this is a really a complex environment in which we live, so it's, there's no single thing that's going to solve all these problems. We have to address antibiotic use in the agricultural sector, and there is some work going on in that area. But you're right, there's a proliferation of antibiotics, antimicrobials in the non-healthcare arena as well. And what role all of that is playing with respect to antibiotic resistance, I really don't know.
And so I know we're coming up on the hour, and I wanted to ask both of you one final question that many have posed here, which is, now that we know about these organisms, what should we be doing as healthcare workers and healthcare systems, number one, to raise public awareness around the organisms, and number two, what message can we convey to our patients and the general public about our response to them?
This is Arjun. I'll begin. You know, I think that what we really do need to emphasize to our patients is the fact that there are these challenges with antibiotic resistance, and I think we should emphasize to them that is why we are being careful with the way we use antibiotics. And I think this comes up particularly in the outpatient setting where, there sometimes is that, well, just give me that Z-Pak because I got it last time. And there needs to be that message that, no, we need to be thoughtful and careful about the way we use antibiotics. And that applies both in the outpatient setting and in hospitals and nursing homes across the board. I think that's a very important message that we can convey to our patients. And I think the other thing that we need to emphasize is that this is not a hopeless situation. It's going to take work, but if we work together and work to improve antibiotic use and work to improve environmental cleaning, this is not a hopeless situation. There is something we can do, but it is going to take dedicated and coordinated action.
Yeah, if I could just jump in too, I think, the thing I would really like to convey, I think, to the folks on the phone, which I think are mainly from healthcare facilities, is that, we're in a different world now with antimicrobial resistance than we probably have ever been in before, where we actually have, health departments, local public health, state public health officials kind of directing efforts to kind of control resistance. And, the old thinking of if a facility has a bunch of resistant patients with resistant bugs, that it's their fault and, it's their problem, hasn't borne out. It's not true, and it really isn't going to solve the problem. So I think, the recognition that I think more and more people are coming to, that this is a big problem. It's all of our problem. When you're in a region with lots of different facilities, the only way it's going to get solved is working together and sharing data and sharing best practices, et cetera. And that is a little bit different than the approach that we've taken before, where we've been very secretive and siloed about it. And I think, keeping that in mind as your public health department, starts to approach you to participate in different activities, I think is going to be critically important. It's like Arjun said, it's not easy. It's not cheap. It's not, this is not going to be a simple road, but it is the only road, I think, at this point.
So I want to thank both of you for some great comments, and I'm going to turn it over and thank PQC for sponsoring this and turn it over to Phyllis.
And thank you, Steve, from Kaiser Permanente, who really did a nice job with those questions. We clearly didn't get to all of them. And we plan on looking at the questions that you've sent in to help us in focusing our webinars as we go forward. As I said earlier, we're going to be continuing the series in three areas, stewardship, prevention in the community, and environmental service strategies. And questions like the ones you raised about UV light, et cetera, will be considered for some of the work that we're going to do on the technology for environmental services. Alex Callan and Arjun Srinivasan of CDC, you were wonderful, and all of those at CDC and at PQC who assisted in putting this informative hour together, I thank you. We've posted the PQC website. You are invited to view this recording at this website. And you will, that should be posted hopefully by the end of the day today. The slide deck will also be there. You are all welcome to view it, refer other folks to view it, and we look forward to being in touch with everybody after it with all of this information and for our next webinars. Thank you, and be well.